condom only yesterday, said the girl. And I haven't got used to your keeping to the left rule. I don't suppose I shall ever get back to New York alive. Perhaps that you saved my life, you wouldn't mind doing me another service. Can you tell me which is the nearest and safest way to a restaurant called the Regent Grill? It's just over there at the corner of Regent Street. That's the safest way. If I were you, I would cross over at the top of the street there, and then work round westward. Otherwise, you will have to cross Piccadilly Circus.
I absolutely
refuse even to try to cross Piccadilly Circus.
Kimmy.
Thank you very much. I will follow your advice. I hope Kimmy. I shall get there. It doesn't seem at all likely. She gave him a little nod and moved away. Jimmy turned to that drugstore at the top of the Haymarket, to which so many Londoners have found healing and comfort on the morning after, and bought the pink drink for which his sister had been craving since he rose from bed. He wondered why, as he drained it, he should feel ashamed and guilty. A few minutes later, he found himself in mild surprise going down the steps of the Regent Grill. It was the last place he had had in his mind when he had left the steamship company's offices in quest of lunch. He had intended to seek out some quiet, restful nook where he could be alone with his thoughts. If anybody had told him then that 5 minutes later he would be placing himself at his own free will within range of a restaurant orchestra playing My Little Grey Home in the West, and the orchestra at the Regent played little else, he would not have believed him. Restaurants in all large cities have their ups and downs. At this time, the Regent Grill is enjoying one of those bursts of popularity for which restaurateurs pray to whatever strange gods they worship. The more prosperous section of London's Bohemia flocked to it daily. When Jimmy had deposited his hat with the robber band that had their cave just inside the main entrance and had entered the grill room, he found it congested. There did not appear to be a single unoccupied table. From where he stood, he could see the girl with the red gold hair. Her back was towards him, and she was sitting at a table against one of the pillars with a little man with eyeglasses, a handsome woman in the 40s, and a small stout boy who was skirmishing with the olives. As Jimmy hesitated, the vigilant head waiter, who knew him well, perceived him and hurried up. "In what moment, Mr. Clarker?" he said, and began to scatter commands among the underlings. "I will place a table for you in the aisle, next to that clerk, please," said Jimmy. The underlings had produced a small table, apparently from up their sleeves, and were draping it in a cloth. Jimmy sat down and gave his order. Ordering was going on at the other table, that manner of a starving clanker. As for the elder woman, she seemed to be wrestling with unpleasant thoughts beyond speech. "I always think that Jimmy Crocker is the worst case I know of, the kind of American young man who spends all his time in Europe and tries to become an imitation Englishman. Most of them are the sort any country would be glad to get rid of. But he used to work once, so you can't excuse him on the ground that he hasn't the sense to know what he's doing. He's deliberately chosen to loaf about London and make a mess of himself. He went to pieces with his eyes open. He's a perfect, hopeless work."